its work. This is the title of our new interactive book. The goal, of course, is maximizing learning opportunities in a three-year program through comprehensive content exposition. The idea started because we have our students for three consecutive years. So we thought that this is very important that we address them during these 3 years with a new material and, of course, comprehensive material, as we will see. We are excited to present our new interactive textbook series that has been carefully designed to meet the needs of the heritage track here at GUU, as we have identified several challenges that are usually faced by both professors and students. The presentation will follow this sequence: the introduction, and then Professor Hany's study, current challenges and primary objectives, key features of the textbook, interactivity, general outcomes, themes, and timeline, and finally the curriculum, methodology, and content. This part is going to be in Arabic, you know, it's an Arabic book. Only the last part is going to be in Arabic, but I have translated most of the things that you should know. It all started in 2019, actually, when Professor Fazza executed a very important study in our program. And the study was entitled Employers' Perceptions of the Arabic Language Competences and Skills of GUU Graduates. In this study, Hany will present actually the outcome of the study before we continue.
Thank you everyone here to attend our presentation. The great minds meet Ms. Abdul here. I'd like to say that we started this study at the end of 2019, I did this study with Professor Laura Reed from the Education at UCL London, and Professor Waleed Masood from the International Institute for Assessment at the University. The purpose of this study was to identify employers' perceptions and needs regarding the skills and competences of GUU graduates. And the study was a mixed method following the sequential exploratory designs. We started with the qualitative data collection, and we moved to the quantitative data collections. And we met with 14 employers and 4 Arabic instructors from GFU. And as you can see here, only 4 of them are graduates from Georgetown, and they became directors in their current work. And it's from Qatar Foundation, the headquarters office and the archive department, from DEFI, Doha International Family Institutes, PwC, CIRS, we met with 3 people there, Teach for Qatar Airways, Government Committee of Office, Qatar International Board, and Security Resolution Center, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and 4 professors from Georgetown. I will jump directly to the findings, and most of the findings focus on how to use Arabic in their current job. And one of the most important, actually these 2, is to link our Arabic classes to the other disciplines. And as you can see here, these are the main goals for the study. And this is for the focus group with the teachers. Regarding the writing skills, the most of the employers ask for the graduates to be able to write formal Arabic content, like official technical reports, memos, emails, formal diplomas, meeting minutes, summary to make summary in Arabic, something like editing written form in Arabic, emails, articles, media messages. For the speaking, they ask for speaking in formal Arabic, give speech for lecture, receptions, sorry, participants in the panel, for meetings, discussions, initiation skills. From these points, we start to think about how to put this in a new textbook for Arabic, for us, for students and for the students.
Thank you. So, we started, as I said, from current challenges, and most importantly, there is a lack of adequate material and books for heritage students, which is causing major hindrance to their learning experience. Usually, we use opinion articles or op-eds from newspapers, and these op-eds are not comprehensive enough for primary learning and should be used only as supplementary materials. Second, much of the material currently used is designed for non-native speakers and can be irrelevant to heritage students. Third, we recognize the importance of exposing heritage students to Arabic language that is relevant to their majors and disciplines, particularly in social studies, as Rani mentioned in his study. Four, we understand the need for a unified curriculum that is based on the accumulation of knowledge so that all students can follow the same curriculum throughout the 3 years of their studies. And currently, we don't have this. The objectives of the textbook, we aim to address these challenges, the previous challenges, by providing material that is specifically tailored to heritage students and their needs. The series will fill the deficiency of knowledge surrounding social studies, language, and technology, particularly in the Arab world. It will cover interdisciplinary topics that are relevant to the GFU majors, so that students can apply their Arabic language skills in a meaningful and practical way. It aims to provide a unified curriculum based on language skills, adequate knowledge, and vocabulary and terminology accumulation. It is designed to streamline heritage classes and assessment processes. This approach actually of streamlining the program and the assessment process will not only unify the program, but will also allow us to create new placement tests based on the levels of the book. Additionally, we can create a new proficiency exam that is also based on the same curriculum. Similar to the curriculum for non-native students, that we use here actually, where we know exactly what is the material that students are being exposed to in each level in order to determine. So, the non-native students are studying Al-Kitab. We know that at year one, they are going to acquire this amount of knowledge, this amount of vocabulary, etc. Second year, they are going to have this. So, currently, we do not have the same curriculum in the heritage track, and this is one of the major goals. The key features of the textbook series: first, thematic organization, second, solid foundation for learning, and finally, the expert digital design. In thematic organization, our textbook series follows a clear thematic order and content structure that ensures a comprehensive and cohesive education resource. Yeah. We recognize the importance of exposing heritage students to relevant Arabic language for their majors and disciplines. The series covers the interdisciplinary topics that are relevant to GFU majors, and the focus is going to be on social studies and other topics. Solid foundation for learning. Students are provided with general knowledge before being exposed to different opinions in newspapers and op-eds. And this is very important, actually, because there's a space for the professor to use the op-eds and the opinion articles or any extra material from outside the book. And it can be related to the major themes in the book. So it's not only the book that's going to be used as the one and final resource, but the professor can use other resources and link them to the book. This approach lays a solid foundation for learning Arabic through informative content. The textbook series follows the proficiency level of the students, ranging from beginner to advanced, and of course it was based on actual guidelines. This approach ensures appropriate challenges for the student while providing a solid foundation for the language learning journey. Finally, the expert digital design. The book is visually appealing and includes educational pictures and graphics. The interactive feature in the textbook series enhances the learning experience for both teachers and students. We have carefully chosen an accessible Arabic font for all students to easily read. Our goal is to make learning Arabic an enjoyable and enriching experience for students at all levels. Of course, now the expert on the digital feature.
I'll start with the demo on another tool because we are not, we need all the digital work and interactive activities for the platform yet. And it's just a platform we can do without publishing it directly. And we are waiting for the ChatGPT to see what will happen. Come on, so can you raise it or just be a problem? This is the platform itself. And this is a group, so we can and transfer the inputs like this, and we have some object we can jump from the main chapter in to another one. Here we have a annotating computation tool where they can with the styles of fingers to write or the mouse. They can also here they can type anything and they can save it and export it as a PDF that they want. Also they, one of the features here is they can save their computation of course. We have something which we include in our book here. It's the interactive activities like this one, and they can answer these questions and they can get instant feedback, or they can send it to their teacher to correct, especially for the productive skills provided. These are the type of interactive exercises one choice with both matching, drag and drop, and many other types of exercises with autocorrect and instant feedback. They can do annotation, record the notes, only files, and also they can add resources like for the seal, the active game, they can upload a PDF file for Word documents to their book.
Now, for the general learning outcomes, the book was divided between these three. Knowledge, skills, knowledge, and capabilities. First, knowledge, you know, the goals are students to understand the meaning of a group of words and terms related to many fields, especially social studies, distinguish the ideas contained in the text, and understand their content based on their structures, transmit in Arabic comprehensive information related to social issues, and explain ideas heard or read, illustrative examples. In skills, as I said, it's also based on the actual guidelines. A student will be able to read texts, understand their structure and the relationships between their elements, analyze texts and other sources of knowledge based on specific critical mechanisms and strategies, write texts for various types and purposes grammatically and morphologically correct using the dictionary algorithm. Finally, communicate and correct Arabic both orally and in writing. The last part is capabilities, and this is mainly grammar, but we are only going to cover basic grammar. Perform linguistic functions in different lives, colony, and practice situations. Use oral and written expression techniques in his or her field of work. Show ability to self-learning and develop his or her capabilities through continuous research. Demonstrate an ability to communicate with other cultures. Express an opinion on global issues. Open to them and appreciate their characteristics. So these actually are in the pamphlet that I just gave you. Spence Sherby, our co-author, and he's also representing the publisher, Habib Publishers from Lebanon, is going to present to us about the curriculum and the content. This part is going to be in Arabic, but everything is in the pamphlet that we have. It's translated into English.
تحية للجميع. نقدم الآن في طارق الرحمن الذي حدد صديقا بناء الكتاب وبالتالي منهجية إعداد أو استراتيجيات التي تابعناها في عملية التأليف. إذا انطلقنا بداية من مجموعة من الأهداف، أردنا أن نحقق هذه الأهداف في نهاية كل سنة من السنوات التعليمية السابقة. بداية الهدف الأول هو تعزيز أو القدرة على استخدام اللغة العربية في مواقف عملية وفي مواقف علمية. ثانيا الهدف الثاني هو القدرة على التفكير والتحليل وبالتالي إبداء الرأي والمقارنة والمقارنات بين النصوص أو بين النصوص المسموعة أو المقروءة. ثالثا هو تطوير مجتمع طبعا على المشاركة على القدرة على التواصل والتفاعل بين أفراد، وذلك لتحقيق ما المشكلة أو حل المشكلة التي انطلقنا منها في دراسة الأستاذ هاني، وذلك لإعداد طالب قادر أن يدخل سوق العمل ويوظف هذه اللغة في سوق العمل. لتحقيق هذه الأهداف كانت أكيد كان لابد من تحضير مجموعة أو تحقيق مجموعة من الكفايات المرتبطة الخاصة باللغة العربية، وهي مرتبطة بالقراءة، الكتابة، التحدث والاستماع وأخيرا عناصر اللغة. وقد قسمنا هذه الكفايات أو أردنا من خلالها تحقيق مجموعة من المخرجات في نهاية كل فصل أو كل سنة دراسة. إذا مخرجات التعلم الخاصة أكيد وضع ضمن مصروفة المدى والتتابع، مصروفة المدى والتتابع مقترنة مباشرة للمحاور التعليمية التي تضمنت مجموعة كبيرة من النصوص التي صرفت عن ذكرها. بداية المخرج الأول أو الكفاية الأولى للقراءة تتضمن مجموعة من المخرجات. المخرج الأول كعنوان يرتبط بالفهم بشكل مباشر، فهم المفردات، فهم المصطلحات المرتبطة مباشرة المتعلقة بموضوعات الاجتماعية، موضوعات تاريخية، موضوعات جغرافية إلى هناك. ثانيا تتضمن أيضا تحديد قدرة على فهم أفكار النص، قدرة على تحديد هذه الأفكار وصولا إلى مرحلة الاستنتاج، وصولا إلى مرحلة إبداء الرأي والمقارنة بين النصوص والتي تتطلب أكيد قدرات معرفية. ثانيا نقدم نموذجا للمخرج كيف سيتم إراده في دليل معلم أو كتاب الدليل الذي سيتبع في سبيل تسهيل عملية التعليم والتعلم، وبالتالي كل مخرج من المخرجات يتم وضع أو تحديد أسس التقويم، أسس التقويم الموزعة انطلاقا من أكيد درجة قدرة الطالب على استيعاب هذا المخرج أو تحقيقه بالأخرى، مبتدئ متوسط متقدم، ثم يتم شرح المخرج مع مجموعة من الأمثلة التوضيحية وربما التدريب. ثانيا بالنسبة إلى كفاية الكتابة وكفاية التواصل الشهوي، أردنا من خلاله أن نحقق مجموعة من المخرجات. هذه المخرجات متعلقة مباشرة بالمشكلات التي أوردناها سابقا بمتطلبات سوق العمل، وبالتالي سيكون الطالب في نهاية الأعوام الثلاث قادرا على كتابة الرسائل، كتابة البريد الإلكتروني، كتابة التقارير، إعداد الندوة إلى ما هنالك من مهارات لابد من أن يكون قد اكتسبها أو تدرب عليها خلال الأعوام الثلاث. هلا بالنسبة إلى منهجية بناء الدروس، اتبعنا منهجية قائمة على دورة التعلم، وبالتالي سنلاحظ أنه في كل درس أو في كل محور انطلقنا منه دمج الطالب في عملية التعلم خلال مجموعة من الأنشطة. هذه الأنشطة التي يستكشف من خلالها أو بفضلها الطالب المحور أو الموضوعات التي يتحدث أو سيدرسها، ثم يشرح هذه الموضوعات، يتوسع في شرحها ويحلل ويبدي رأيه وصولا إلى التطبيق. وأما بالنسبة إلى الأسئلة، الأنشطة التي وضعت، هذه الأسئلة أو الأنشطة وضعت وفق تصنيف بلوم، وبالتالي لم تكن عشوائية، إنما التزمنا في وضعها المستويات المعرفة الدنيا ومستويات المعرفة العليا انطلاقا من المعرفة أو التذكر وصولا إلى التقويم والابتكار في النهاية. هذا مما يتكون البيئة. صنعنا الآن نموذجا لوحدة أو محور يتضمن درسا لمحاولة تشتيت طريقة بناء الكتاب والأقسام التي يتكون أو يتألف منها، والتي ستكون موحدة في معظم أو كل المحاور وفي كل السنوات الدراسة. إذن في كل كتاب أو كل قسم يتضمن مجموعة من المحاور. هذه المحاور مؤلفة أو
This is the first chapter, for example, and the first chapter is talking about the parts of the first chapter. So first here is the doors, and of course this is also for the professor. So the first the chapter is consisted of several texts and several lessons.
في كل محور يتم تحديد أهداف المحور، ثم نحدد أيضا أهداف مقدمة المحور، يعني كل محور مقدمة، هذه المقدمة تعد القادم لكي يستكشف الموضوعات التي سيتم التطرق إليها في الدروس المطلقة. بداية تتضمن المقدمة قراءة صورة، هذه القراءة أكيد تساعد على اكتساب مهارة التواصل أو فهم المستوى البصري. ثم يلي ذلك مرحلة أو قسم إضاءة معرفية. في هذا القسم يتعرف الطالب إلى مجموعة من المصطلحات أو موضوعات ترتبط مباشرة بالمحور الذي يتحدث أو يعالجه. ثم ثالثا المرحلة عمل تطبيقي استنتاجي. في هذه المرحلة يتم إعطاء الطالب نوع من بحث ممهد يسمح له بالتعرف أو بتعلم الذاتي للدخول في المحور، وبالتالي لبدء بفهم أو تحليل الدروس. بعد ذلك
في أدرس حلو
أو مرحلة تهيئ القراءة. في هذه المرحلة هي مرحلة تصبر مرحلة عرض النص، وبالتالي يتم تنمية مهارة التوقع، مهارة الاستكشاف، يحاول هذا الطالب التنبؤ بما يتضمنه النص من خلال مجموعة من المؤشرات الدلائل، من خلال دراسة العنوان أو من خلال دراسة الصور المسبقة للنص. بعدها يعرض النص، أكيد هذا النص يرتبط
بالمحور بشكل مباشر ويرتبط بنصوص المتلاحقة التي متواجدة أو التي عرضت أو وضعت في هذا المحور أثبتت فيه. بعدها تبدأ المناقشة أو الدراسة التحليلية. في مرحلة الدراسة التحليلية وقراءة المصدر الكبير يتم بداية مناقشة عامة. هذه المناقشة العامة هي مناقشة استنشافية، محاولة قراءة النص أو فهم العناصر الأساسية التي تكون النص من كلمات مفاتيح من حق المعجب إلى ما هنالك، وبالتالي هي تساعد على فهم المصطلحات، فهم الكلمات الجديدة، تساعد على محاولة تفكيك النص لتمهيد عملية بنائه في مرحلة الثانية التي هي مرحلة المناقشة التفصيلية. نتيجة هذه المرحلة وفي هذه المرحلة مجموعة من الأنشطة التي تنطلق من عملية الفهم وصولا إلى عملية الابتكار في النشاط العاشر. إجمالا هذه المرحلة مكونة من 9 إلى 10 أنشطة تقريبا. تتضمن مجموعة من التمارين التحليلية، التمارين التي يبدي فيها الطالب رأيه، التمارين التي يحاول فيها الطالب أن يقارن الأفكار أو المعلومات المقدمة مع معلومات أخرى، ثم ينتج في النهاية بحثاً صغيراً مرتبطاً مباشرة بموضوع النص. تأتي هذه المرحلة المرحلة الأخيرة وهي مرحلة جد أساسية مهمة في كتابنا بإنتاج على النص، وهي انفتاح القراءة. مرحلة انفتاح القراءة أي الخروج إلى عالم الإنتاج. ينتج هنا الطالب مجموعة من الكتابات أو يحقق مجموعة من وضع أو الأوضاع إذا كنا تواصلية. في هذه المرحلة نستطيع أن ننجز متطلبات سوق العمل، بريد إلكتروني، كتابة تحرير مقالة إلى ما هنالك من أنشطة.
شكرا. So I will summarize quickly in English lesson to a sample of each lesson. Almost each lesson will begin with a picture, an interactive picture, or interactive exercises after a picture. All pictures were selected actually carefully. And then we will start by discussing the information that the students got. We're able to extract from pictures. As you can see, most of the exercises are interactive. And then this is the text. The text, for example, is about demography in the Arab world. Of course, as the student shall explain, the students will be able to understand the text, deconstruct all the structures in it, and learn the new vocabulary. I will jump to this is very important because this is outside the world of the text. Here where professors and students can explore other options outside the lesson itself and find other sources. And finally, the writing. The writing skill is also included in each, or the research is included in each lesson. So on the pamphlet that I gave you, the last page has the themes of the first semester. You know, the textbook is actually divided according to our program division, with each year being divided into two parts, the first semester and the second semester. The first one, students will be exposed to social themes from different fields, including sociology, demography, geography, and economics, with a particular focus on the Arab world. You can see the pamphlet, all the topics that are already included in there. In the second semester, the book will cover the history of the Arab world, including topics and themes from ancient times to modern times, including Islamic history and medieval Islamic and Yeah, this is the second analytical testing. Finally, Arabic and its world is a comprehensive dossier that aims to address the challenges of teaching Arabic to university students. I agree with you. We believe that our dossiers will provide a valuable learning experience for both students and professors, and we hope that it will contribute to the overall success of the program. Thank you so much, and please, if you have any questions, join me. Now 20 minutes for questions.
Yes.
First of all, we
mentioned this interesting discovery before she takes on one iteration about many years of so two questions. One, how does this book relate to the work that you've been doing with the team for the last 10 years or so? Brings the practice of the materials. Is that separate or does that lead to this or does it lead to that like separate?
Yeah. No, it doesn't link. This is separate. But of course, based on our experience in teaching that old material that we used to teach, we came up with this new. So it is based on it, but it's not part of it.
And my second question was, you talk about a book, you're likely to link that with many volumes.
Yes.
Given that you've got 3 years worth of curriculum, how big is it?
It's also 3 volumes.
Okay.
Yeah. It might be 6 volumes actually, each volume for each semester, yeah. Right. 1 volume for each semester, yeah. And it will be ready by July, by physically.
Yeah.
Yes.
Great work, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Just 3 questions, it's more about the process of writing a test. Do you plan to study in an hour to get some feedback over a couple of years? And what is the final thing?
No, actually, this is a good thing. The publisher is very flexible. So, and you know, the important part of it is the digital one. So it's going to be subject to changes all the time. You can amend it, you can change it. And if the professors started to teach it, so they can give us all the recommendations that we change that accordingly. Yeah, this was the plan, actually. So it's not completely final, but this is what we are going to start with. And we tried some of the lessons already this year in our classes, and they were really good. Some of the students are, yeah. Yes?
So, just based on the lesson you showed, the entire text is in Arabic. So this is intended for the Arabic, or will it be also some sections, for example?
No, it's in Arabic. No,
sure. Like instructions that we use for something.
No, because the idea of the heritage learners that we immerse them completely in Arabic language. So no English used in the book at all.
So some English words. Just a few ones.
Yeah. Oh yeah, of course, like but not instructions, yeah. Yes.
Thanks for this last presentation.
Thank you.
I'm interested in the digital dimension of this because we're talking about changing the industry itself, you publish it.
Yes.
So my question, what is it that this experiment brings into or tells us about changes in publishing itself, when you publish it, the learning itself, are there changes within the learning itself that are matching those changes to e-publishing, interactive publishing, and how do we prepare ourselves for those? This is the trend for the future.
Yeah, well, I think this is Dennis.
I think we are trying to do something like study when we publish the digital part. We are planning to do kind of applying the TAM model, the technology acceptance model, where we can test how the students receive the digital form or the digital platform and the interactive activities. Then we can change accordingly. Answer this one?
Thank
you so much.
Yes.
Yeah, congratulations to all three of you. This is terrific. I have two questions. First, you mentioned that this was designed with GUQ students in mind. To what extent is this going to travel with heritage learners elsewhere or other related disciplines?
Yeah, actually, we hope that it's going to travel because there is no material for that. Very minimal, you cannot find a lot of material, especially books that are designed for heritage learners. And in the Gulf, we have this unique type of heritage. So there are no books for this. For example, we have another co-author with us who works at the Doha Institute, and she is also planning to implement a book there. And it will be also in Beirut. They have a new program for heritage learners. Over summer, they have intensive Arabic summer program for heritage learners. They are also planning to start working with them. So we are hoping to join them.
Second question, go back to what Mahima asked, and it has to do with pedagogy. You made a point of the book being visually appealing,
yeah,
and how you pick the pictures carefully. I am one of those old-fashioned guys who just refuses to have even tables in books, and I mean, kind of
even in textbooks.
In textbooks, yeah, and you know, publishers like figures and tables and summaries and all that. And can you kind of walk us through the process of what guided your thinking in terms of the visual layout?
Yeah. So I'll show you this one. This is not our book, but this is published by the same publisher.
So not as good as your book.
Of course not. Yeah. No, that's actually, our book has more features than this one. So the idea, you know, Arabic for students, especially Arab students, is a very boring topic to study. Yeah.
Having pictures is nicer. It makes it more appealing.
Yeah, and the point is to make it more appealing and more fun to study. Also the interactive exercise in using pictures, this we want to make them speak. The traditional way of teaching Arabic is just studying grammar. Now we focus on skills, mainly speaking, listening, reading and writing. So, and one of our major goals is speaking because this is our proficiency exam. So when we test students for proficiency, we don't make them write. It's only speaking. So in this way, it forces them to speak and in an appealing way. So that's the point. When we used to use some, you know, as you said, traditional books, then it becomes more boring for the students. So yeah, this is what we thought. Yes.
Yeah, the question about the equipment, so in styling heritage speakers, women are it's kind of the church of this right. So I was first curious about how are you designing activities for heritage speakers? How do you address it so that you miss the group of students who all have a different knowledge and
yes, exactly. The idea came from our experience when we found out that students, they don't really know a lot about the Arab world. And they don't even know the terminology that is used in social studies. So when we used to give them opinion articles, these are advanced articles. So we think that there's a gap between their knowledge and these articles, right? So these articles usually have a lot of terminology. For example, industrial revolution. They don't know what industrial revolution is in Arabic, and they cannot define it in Arabic. So so we thought that these terms and the social studies language is very important for them as a background before they start reading op-eds and opinion articles or advanced articles, right? Because most of the published articles and newspapers are addressing Arabs, are addressing people who can read and write and intellectually in a better level. So so we struggle with this. However, because they are heritage students, We base all of this on their knowledge of their own language, which is not MSA, not modern standard for Fusha. It is more of a colloquial language. Of course, again, you know, we have several colloquials in the Arab world, but there is, of course, a base for all of them. And this is the one that we want to use all the time. So we use what they have of colloquial language and transform it into MSA. This is the difference between teaching Arabic and English.
So the part of the grammar that you provided, do you feel that that's on an individual basis, by the grammar?
No, for grammar, of course, not on an individual basis, because most of them are weak in grammar. That's like, you know, any student who is not specialized in Arabic language, any Arab is weak in grammar if they are not specialized in Arabic language. So we don't fill the gap individually in grammar, but we use skills much more. So when they are speaking and you correct them all the time without really going deep in the grammatical concepts, so they get used to speak correctly and use something like that.
Yeah, that's something that our ultimate goal here at the university, that the students, emerging students, need to give that proficiency exactly, which is basically in speaking in Spain.
So even if they do some grammar mistakes in that proficiency exam, and we ignore it, we understand. Yes?
Mine is more to comment how it appeals to me there. And the students and over the years towards my proficiency. My heartfelt congratulations.
Thanks for so much.
And to the leaders and people in space, this is needed work. And also, can we see how you thought of the structure between the years and how you coordinated this thematic in year one, year two,
Yes. Yes.
Congratulations again.
Thank you.
Congratulations for today. Nothing for many more days. We need to say congratulations.
Thank you so much.
My question is more so you could elaborate a little bit more on the content that you use specifically for the historical analysis or historical text that you will use or things that you're using. To bring down the different civilizations. I have a keen interest in the one I see as an archaeologist, and the ones archaeology and heritage to go hand in hand, and as we are trying to develop tangible diplomacy and tangible heritage here at GPQ, I'm curious to see first the criteria by which you actually divide the civilizations and both, and how it relates to language acquisition.
Yes. So I'll start with language acquisition. This is what we do now, even before using the book. We try to teach language through content, especially for Arabic, because they, as I said, they can read, they can understand what they are reading to understand. So we use the content in order to teach them more linguistics concepts. Now for the revision of the book, I thought that the first semester of each year should have more interactive exercises and more interactive approach. Because usually after summer they need more to refresh their Arabic. So the first semester of each year is going to cover social studies without history. So mainly, as I said, demography, economics, geography, etc. Now, at the very beginning, for example, here, the very first chapter is going to be about humans and their personal circle. So, you know, their needs, their neighborhood, the city, the country, etc., from a demographic point of view. And then after each semester, then the level will be higher, and then we cover more complicated topics until we reach, for example, the evolution of communication and transportation, and then oil and gas, food, weapon, energy, all of these topics that are advanced, and they are going to be studied by advanced students. But this is semester one, year one, year two, year three, all of these semesters are going to be social studies. Then in the second semester, because it's more history, it's more rigid, and reading historical texts a little bit more advanced. So the three semesters, the second semester in each year is going to be on historical concepts. Again, we start with ancient civilizations in the Arab world, so Mesopotamia, the Pharaohs, the Phoenicians, etc. And then Western empires a little bit. Second year is going to be medieval history, mainly in the Arab world and the relation to Europe and stuff related to the Arab world. The third year is modern times, after the Ottoman Empire, after the World War. And through reading this, through reading history, our main goal, of course, to teach the language, but also to make them, to enable them to understand history and social studies in Arabic language. Yes, please.
First of all, congratulations, Pedagogy, and other students. I wanted to ask, how are you incorporating grammar lessons into the text?
You'll see that in class. So, actually, it's exactly what we do. For example, in our first lesson, we encountered, let's say, the idafa concept, idafa or adjective. It was mentioned in the first lesson. But the lesson is not talking about adjectives, it's talking about history, right? So I take this example from the actual text, and then I explain it more, and we give more examples, and then we look for it in other lessons, exactly like what we do. Yeah, and then of course you have to reproduce the concept that you know. Yes?
I think it's that. So once again, congratulations for the thing. I'm a student. I'm not personally speaking Arabic. I live in French, but I came here to this event because I wanted to see that the languages that are happening, learning in particular. And I know that the main issue here is about language, right? But you also have written kind of history, right? It's intangible. So is it just that you met the first question? Did you write all of this for yourself?
Yeah, all of us actually worked on this, but some material is, we used authentic material from other writers.
Ah.
Yeah, so not all of it, we didn't write everything in it, but most of it was written by us. Yeah.
Ah, okay.
And based, of course, on, you know, like other sources.
Yes, because I wanted to know.
But this is not a history book.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because historians, they have a huge role in achieving the kind of people.
Yes.
And you have to be really careful about where we think we
should. Exactly.
So, what was your methodology in choosing a particular writer that appealed to you?
Yeah. Actually, my original training was in history. I'm a historian by training. I did my master's in history at the UB, and I know how to read history to understand. So, my methodology was mainly using sources that are kind of agreed on. Now, we didn't go into details because we left this for students to look for and search and maybe debate or discuss. Since we are not going to teach them history, as I said, this is an open area for them to do the projects and research and then discuss the material that is in the book. Most of the texts are not completely historical, but they feed into learning some knowledge about history. So, we didn't follow one specific historical methodology for that.
Okay. When you have two types of things, the first one is the new place.
Yes.
The second one is outside the world of the place. But
And sometimes they might be, you know, in conflict with these two guys, for the students to see that there are different methodologies.
Yeah, thank you. We have not a vision of the leader question. That's my head on this. I hope I'm not putting you on the spot. For the next edition, how do you see AI either improving or challenging these since we're talking about fast-changing, technology-driven world? Mm-hmm. Is that an opportunity on the topic?
I think that you need to think about how to call that the AI in the language into the environment. I believe that one day, I believe that we can have a kind of algorithm or something that feeds only the text in specific levels of language levels and create kind of activities based on the level description to have framework.
Yes.
So to differentiate between proficiency, where you do it, and book. So my first impression is that the book is not oriented just to proficiency about building.
Yes.
So you believe proficiency is only at the halfway. But secondly, is there anything really about given the kind of skills you need to employ as one, is there anything about changing proficiency after you bring?
We had this discussion like years ago, but I think we have to follow actual guidelines, and they only have oral efficiency. Also, on main campus, they only use oral efficiency. We thought about including writing, reading, like in the article, but it's not in the guidelines. Now, so for linking the proficiency with the book, this is very important because most of the texts that we give for students in proficiency are mainly from social studies. So it's either about politics, history, current, So, but students are not very familiar with these. So currently there is a huge gap between proficiency and what they are learning. Because mainly we use, as I said, either newspapers or ads or literature. And literature in this test, I mean, literature for heritage students in the first 3 years is not beneficial at all for the proficiency. So now, in this case, they are going to be exposed to historical language, social studies language, political language, etc.
And this year, this semester, we have kind of something called the heritage program, where students come
to practice
proficiency with us before they go to the exam. Mm-hmm. So by the time they get to the end of your series of course,
yes,
that's going to be well beyond proficiency. So I don't know if it's because you start by saying what the employers want, and it's all about the interplay to write this, write the books, write
exams, and all of this is included in the book.
Yeah. So, but that's not included in
proficiency. No, yeah, exactly. They are not included in proficiency, but included in our book. Yeah, it's going to be beyond, of course, proficiency. But you know, students have to take a post-advanced course to set for proficiency. So we are kind of preparing them also for post-advanced. Yes.
So congratulations.
Thank you so much.
I can't help but feel jealous with the heritage students learning about diversity on these topics. So my question is, do you see this book being modified for non-heritage students in the future? Or like in the near future?
No, it's not in the near future. And I'm sure it's very hard to compete with that. But you can become a heritage scholar. But hopefully, if this was a success with students, we might of course think about
another bridge.
Yeah, inshallah. Thank you so much.